L bans targeted at Skara. Skara has been going more towards long range AP carries now, though, like Ziggs and Vhagar. I guess that counts as well. Meanwhile, Pabelter, like we said, he's played so many different champions. And the last one that he won on was LeBlanc. LeBlanc is 11-0 in the LCS right now, by the way. That is just ridiculous. I don't think that LeBlanc is going to be on the table.
Well, she won't get to affect that 11 side of the score too much. She does, however, get a ban coming into this game. And what, you know, just simply as these ban comes in, could be the reason that everybody's shying away from Jinx so much, especially Cutie Pie.
So Jinx does not have her own escape. That's one of the reasons why she's not used very much over in Korea. They never really latched onto her, especially with the popularity of Sivir late game. Sivir speeding up a whole bunch of bruisers is very hard for Jinx to deal with.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll see if somebody gets her some new cleats and gets her off the bench anytime soon. Right now, just the normal bans coming in. A lot more Lulu being seen banned out here. Is that possibly in the hands of either Pobelter or Skara? And then the supports from what we've seen lately.
Right. I mean, I would mostly consider Lulu a mid-ban nowadays because she's so popular in the mid lane. So it's actually Dignitas that target Pobelter with three bans. And Evil Geniuses do not throw any of those classic Skara bans back out. Maybe because, you know, he's shown that he's going back to things like Ziggs and Karthus nowadays. Right. These long-range AP carries, there's so many of them that he could choose from. Nobody's really going to be banning out Karthus or something like that.
No, but they will be first picking the Lease when it is left up, so that'll be pretty good, which isn't too bad for Snoopy. He's not going to have to go on a new jungler unless he himself chooses it, because a lot were left up here in the banning phase.
Right. He's got his pick of the litter now, and he's actually been a very diverse jungler. He's not been scared to pick up things he hasn't even played in months, so I think they'll be able to leave that jungle pick till later. They've even talked about how they just try and get very strong champions at the beginning and decide where those champions are going to be laning after they've already got their full set.
And we see, talked a little bit about Thresh today, that champion that all the supports really want to grab. He's a playmaker when it needs to be, and he can do the defense when it really needs to happen.
He brings the best escape in the game to your team. Yep. Having the Lantern save so many deaths that that would be unavoidable any other way. So you bring that defensive capability and you already attach it to something like the Blitzcrank hook offensive ability. It's very similar. He's got so many options here for both offensive and defensive play.
The big man does slip by this game. He's actually going to be in the hands of Pobelter. Maybe. We did see Gragas in the jungle in the early part of this split. We haven't seen it too much lately. On Dignitas' side, since Annie has been banned out, that is played seven times by KiwiKid. He's going to resort back to Leona. This will be his third time on that champion.
I do like that move, getting KiwiKid on something he's a little bit more uncomfortable with. We've seen the impact that his Annie, especially once he gets mobility boots and roams, can have on a game.
The Trundle pick coming out. Cruiser has fared on that, or had tried a game on that, did not fare too well. So Dignitas is composing a team that they don't have too many wins from, but that Elise was still a very big pick for them in the priority. Pantheon being grabbed up on the side of Evil Geniuses, who's been having a good time in that early game jungle.
Yeah, picking Trundle really early here is interesting from Dignitas, because Inox is a player that loves playing carry top laners, and Trundle thrives against tanks. So Inox now is free to pick one of his carry top laners and not really have to worry as much about the Trundle ultimate as, you know, someone maybe if he had locked in like Mundo early. I don't know. We might even see Inox going back to, there we are. Inox will be playing some type of carry. As we said, Evil Geniuses swap around the lanes once they have all their champions. So there's a couple options. Gragas or Pantheon could go in the jungle. But Pantheon in the long lane is very dangerous.
Yeah.
So it'll probably be the champion with the dash that will go up into that lane. That one will be Gragas this time around.
Awesome pick up on both sides. So we get the Gragas and the Ziggs coming into both games. Both teams coming with wave clear and siege here. It should be an interesting matchup.
I like this too by Evil Geniuses because they saved their top lane pick. I don't think it's going to go tank Gragas. It'll just be AP Gragas into this Trundle, and they're going to have so much damage, this EG team. And they won't really have to worry about who Trundle's ulting. And they're just going to try and split the team up and kill whoever they catch out of position.
All right, as the teams made their selections, let's see who you guys selected to get the first win of the day here. According to LOLESports.com, 68% of you think that Dignitas will snap their losing streak, which is a little more, obviously, than I think EG fans would have wanted them to get.
Yeah, this is definitely one of the closer votes, though. Mm-hmm. We've seen so many votes
that
being
is true.
90%.
That is true.
All of the fans of the LCS seem to have very similar opinions on a lot of the matchups. This one, finally, a little dissent. And I think it's going to be a pretty interesting match. Like I said, more damage here from EG. I like this direction that they're going with because part of the problems have been they've been initiating and not having follow-up. When everybody's on a playmaker and everybody has the potential, the damage potential, then they won't hesitate. And they'll just go after whoever they knock out of the way with Gragas ulti, and they'll kill that target.
Yeah.
And everybody will, you know, be every man for himself. They'll have to dodge out after that.
Everyone's moving. You don't have to really make the call. When the jungler makes that one extra step or whoever's throwing the initiation, then everybody's moving in on the fight. And that's what we've seen a lot of teams coming and having finally towards the mid part of the split. That's where we see a few of these wins kicking in. Right now, Dignitas 6-6 versus Evil Geniuses. 4-8 on the split. We'll see if they can put a win in the column here as they face off. We are on the Rift for your first match of the day.
Also, having Papelter on Zed is very beneficial for this EG team because in the games where EG does well, it's because Papelter starts out well and he takes over the game. Zed is a perfect champion for completely taking over a game once you get a lead. If Papelter can get that lead on Zed, he can split push by himself and deal with any of these champions. Trundle does not have a very easy time against Zed once he gets a couple items. So I really do like having Pobelter with that potential. Crumbs, though, he's really in a tight spot.
Uh-oh, Crumbs not looking good. He does have that W, but he's going to go down very quickly. EG picking up first blood in the first minute.
Yeah, he wandered a little bit too far into enemy territory there. Though, luckily, he did not panic and burn any summoners. No flash down for Crumbs.
Well, he's back up. The respawn times aren't that long, so beneficial for him. Already back in the game, you were talking about Pobelter's Zed, and even more to have that aggression from the Pantheon in the jungle. You can get Pobelter going right away, especially with what happened so far. That first kill's his.
Exactly. It's the early start that I was going to talk about for Pobelter. He's really going to like that one because Zed versus Ziggs is all about can Zed ever get his kill on Ziggs. And with the Pantheon jungle, it makes that definitely a possibility. Scar is going to have to play defensive, and it's going to be a little rough for him. I think that he might even be giving up more CS than usual because he's so worried about the Pantheon jungle.
Farming from afar with the Q. We'll see if Scar can get those bombs out. Get the correct amount of CS. We all know Scar loves his CS, so I'm pretty sure he'll be able to get that still and keep himself in this game. They're both already trading as they get to the lane, and we'll see how this turns out from here.
And I like where Pobelter went with his First Blood money. Pretty much every pre-minion wave level First Blood that we've seen in the LCS, everyone uses that money to buy a pink ward. Starting out the game with a pink ward, level one, does a lot for your team. You can see he's already placed it in that small bush of the river. That will not be found out until the jungler roams through there, because the early stages of the game, there's a very low chance pink wards are going to be found. Only person really making a lot of moves at this time is the jungler.
We'll see what kind of moves they will be making. We did see Snoopy going for the wolves, as well as Crumbs making the same path, but he is already on the red. So Crumbs may be making himself apparent in these lanes a little bit quicker. 3 minutes into the game, we're still watching Pobelter versus Scar. Like we were saying, that old versus the young, and that lane is going to be, I think, pretty bloody as the game goes on.
Yeah, Scar, he's all about trying to harass Pobelter while he's CSing. Area of effect damage from Ziggs. Inox does exactly the same thing with his Gragas, because all of his spells are AoE as well.
And this is a really great matchup for Gragas as well. Crumbs and both Snoopy kind of hiding on the outside here. You can see the double buffs ticking away on them, and Snoopy is just kind of taunting Crumbs, telling him he knows he's there. But Inox, that Gragas barrel we don't talk about very much, has the attack speed debuff that Cruiser on Trundle actually has a steroid for, so he kind of negates that.
It's a good tool for Inox to use to make sure that Cruiser will not want extended engages, because the attack speed debuff is definitely significant. And Cruiser doesn't get his buff unless he does put down his W. So I do like this matchup, and that's the benefits of counter picking. They were able to pick the Gragas and decide where they wanted him to go much later. You know, I do want to touch on that Snoopy point because we just saw an interesting interaction with the junglers, yeah. even though nothing happened. Snoopy was aware that his top lane is pushed, and that's the most vulnerable lane for a gank. So he immediately went up there, but he didn't face check a bush. You never want to face check against the Lee's. Meanwhile,
doesn't have to be a face check. You just have to get close to that one. Hook, line, and sinker. Snoopy's persistence pays off in the top lane.
Very well played by him, but it's Crumb's chance to answer here. Pobelta's on the far side, so he should be able to get out of this one.
Like that. Using the wall already, he positions himself for a quick out. You see Scar doesn't want any of that. And just simple movement. Pobelta playing it calm, cool, and collected. Gets himself out of that situation.
Yeah. Didn't even have to use a shadow there. Good dodge on the cocoon. Mm-hmm. Pobelta showing his confidence.
We'll see if they can get back for another one. Snoopy's pretty low in the jungle, so I don't think he'll be coming back too soon, but Crumbs's try in the middle has just left him as well, going back to farm up experience. A bit of a gold lead here for EG, now 800 in the lead as we see Cutie Pie and Kiwi Kid trying to pressure, and Crepo, a Yellow Pete right to the turret here. As Cutie Pie, you can see him interchanging those auto attacks to get damage onto Yellow Pete.
Yeah, that's something we talk about a lot at the beginning of the games is, you know, how Caitlyn's and Leona's like to push early so that they can get level advantage and, you know, fight with the creep wave as well as go for the early level 2 aggression. Now, that also does open you up to jungle ganks. So both junglers need to be looking at that lane. Crumbs for counter ganking and Snoopy just for regular aggression.
Level 6 is very close in mid lane. You can see Skara using the rubber ducky to get away real quick, but he has not been back to buy, so he knew he was going to be taking quite a bit of damage. Who has been back to buy is Inox, and it looks like he's gone 3 rings for himself.
And I like how Pobelta did not hesitate to shove that wave very quickly. He'd been shaving his shadow so that as soon as Scar is gone, he can shove it into the turret, make him lose on CS, or force the jungler out into the open.
Calls
and
out Crumbs.
Those 3 Doran's rings that you pointed out, they might come into effect pretty soon here because Snoopy wants a repeat gank on Crumbs or Cruiser.
Also going to help Inox a little bit. He's not buying too many stats for Cruiser to subjugate away for his ultimate, and he keeps himself a little healthy in lane. You see level 6 just hitting, and this could be a bounce back for Snoopy to get a good Aegis in. But right now,
they really want a good ult from Inox to get him into position.
That's the body slam. They hit it back. Beautifully done. Very textbook. And it looks like Cruiser, not the ignite this time, but the body slam for Inox. 3-0 now, 7 minutes into the game for EG.
You have to be worried about that level 6 as Cruiser. You got to know that Inox is looking for the displacement. As soon as they have that level 6, he calls Snoopy up. They've had really good communication in the top lane for EG in the last couple of weeks, I think.
Yep.
They're really working on that.
A lot more patience to all of their plays. It doesn't look as erratic. They definitely have things tied down a bit more. 10,300 gold to the 9,100 right now of Dignitas. As Snoopy, all your lanes are winning. Start heading to the jungle. Start affecting the other jungler.
Now, he hasn't charged up his passive yet, so he doesn't have the block, but he has gotten into position to counter the second blue, knowing that Crumb starts at his blue.
Ooh.
Whoa! Close one. They were able to make sure that Skari doesn't get it.
Yellow Pete, effective at getting himself away. Only takes a little bit of damage, but a very good play, like you said, with Snoopy's aggression in the top lane, Cruiser being so far behind, they go for blue. EG starts to open up some opportunities.
Right, so denying it from Scar is pretty big, but the next thing that we're going to look for from Snoopy is his level 6 gank. The man drop is going to come in soon. They would like to use it on the bottom lane because then you can transfer any sort of kill or pressure from the bottom lane into a dragon objective, but the mid lane is also a pretty good choice because Pobelta post level 6 does have the ability to kill Scar, and Scar has not gone barrier, which is sort of common in many Zig players.
Oh, wow. Give Inox a little bit, and he will take everything. 210 health sit on Cruiser right now. The flash body slam coming in, and the blast barrel is going to be able to tech this one up. Another one for Inox. We're saying,
Kobe. And there it was. At the mid, exact same time, the man drop does come in. They're able to take out Skara. And bottom lane gets a hook as well.
Ooh, they didn't want that. Crumbs is there to help a little bit. They get good damage onto Kiwi Kid and Cutie Pie with the culling. as they give themselves a little bit of breathing room as well. And you were talking about Inox being on the carry junk or the carry top lanes, rather. It seems to be working.
Those are the champions he likes to play. Now, let's take a look at this actual gank. As Pantheon, when you're coming in, that death mark's going to be plenty. As Pantheon, when you're coming in, you use your Grand Skyfall.
Yeah.
Start spamming your W as soon as the circle, the second circle shows up, because you can get even more range by queuing up that spell. And you can see as soon as Snoopy lands, he's able to get the stun and spear onto Skara, which is all that Pobelter needed, just that little bit of extra damage.
And this definitely has Dignitas on their heels. They weren't even ready to pressure for Dragon coming off of that top turret. We see Cruiser trying to get a little bit of experience off the Wraith, so they're really gasping for air right now, at least in the early part of the game. Super well played by EG so far.
Yeah, it's a huge benefit of going with the Pantheon jungle. You have very, very high potential for the early ganks. And he was able to stifle Crumb's early movements. As we said, he went to the top lane, which was his most vulnerable lane. He was looking not to gank himself, but just to counter Crumbs. And all he had to do was see Crumbs walking in the river, and they were able to delay the early game of Elise, which is really huge.
Pobelter knows he can harass Skara while he goes for his Wraiths, and with that much control, they know they can easily take Dragon. They have Vision to Cruiser in the top lane, just farming away freely, but that's all he can do. EG has set these things up for themselves perfectly.
Pobelter going over the wall. Inox following
him. Want this
is a five-man gank down bottom.
It's a party in the bot lane. Cutie Pie is going to get the first present, but that cast just gives everybody a consolation prize. Inox getting good damage onto him. They turn one onto Crumbs, but that's going to be it for everything they put in the bottom lane.
Snoopy does not join. He actually goes to hold that mid lane. He has to be careful against Ziggs. As a jungler, especially a jungler who's building full damage, even CSing at your turret is sometimes a dangerous game, trying to hold for your mid laner, because Ziggs can get plenty of harass down.
The turret does not always spell safety. 11 minutes into the game, definitely the case coming in for Dignitas. 6-0, a 4,000 gold lead already coming in for EG. That consists of the first dragon and just multiple succession or ganks in the top lane, and they just went to the bottom lane. We saw Snoopy finally a Grand Skyfall in mid to take down Skara. Mm-hmm. They're making sure every lane loses hard for Dig.
Yep, they're doing a really good job. The only lane, really, that Snoopy hasn't visited was the bottom lane, and both of the solos that he ganked for went down bottom for him. So
yeah,
everybody really making their rotations around.
And again, EG is in place, getting a little more damage on the turret. Dignitas is coming out of their base for at least a few of them here. Cutie Pie, Kiwi Kid still trying to return to that bottom lane where a wave is crashing into the turret. Pobelter trying to keep map vision in their favor along with the kills. They're doing everything they need to stay on top here. And Dignitas, they want to try to cut this down soon, but nobody can get there to help.
They're going for another Skyfall in the mid.
Oh, he's forced to walk into this one almost. Goes for the Aegis. It's blocked in the same time, but they're still going to be able to get enough damage on the kill. Crumbs is always just a little too far away.
Yep, no escaping that one again. Stupid gets the long W off to snag Skara.
Oh, no
way.
And
it is safe to say that they are dominating this early game.
Oh! Itsy Bitsy Spider came down quite hard on that one. 8-0 now. Almost 20,000 gold to their name. EG pushes. New word. We're going to write that one down. Pushes the mid lane, and now they're just going to open up this map. The last one there is the bottom turret. They're probably going to get it by 15 minutes.
This is just complete domination.
Yeah.
This is, at this point, a lot of teams, if they were scrimming, this would be a start over for the scrim. They would probably be surrendering and starting it over. But Dignitas, they really, really are going to have a tough time farming at their own turrets. They really just have to wait out the storm here. And it's up to EG, really, to continue to make those aggressive movements. We'll probably continue to see Grand Skyfalls at turrets, looking for dives.
Well, you still got Inox in the top lane. Gragas, no stranger to pushing a lane as hard as possible. And we can see that Inox, in his last buy, sold one of those rings to get his Athene's Unholy Grail. So got that extra ring for a little health in the lane to fight against Cruiser. Sold it off to pawn some more gold. Great work so far in the laning phase, and now kind of pressuring out into the fight phase. As we see, Dignitas has been having a little trouble around dragons and when five people approach bottom.
Mm-hmm. But luckily for Dignitas, you know, this is a lot of damage here for EG and not a lot of tankiness. If they can catch somebody from the Fog of War, you know, Elisa's great at catching people. If she can actually get the jump on Snoopé, they might be able to get a lot of that gold back by picking up a kill on one of these full offensively built champions.
Skara trying to build up the Zhonya's and stack the tier in mid. We've seen him do that before when he's against the ADs, looking for that shield from the Seraphs in the long game as well as the Zhonya's. Cruiser just kind of sitting and watching his turret go down. He's had such a rough game up here.
Yeah. The early pick on Trundle not working out for them. Inox gets to play one of his carries, and again, there's a Grand Skyfall coming.
Forcing the flash out of Scar. That means the Rubber Ducky's going to have to come down. The Mega Inferno Bomb. One more hit. Oh, no. He levels up as well.
Snoopé's stuck, though. There's nowhere to go.
No, turret shot. He takes it.
So he didn't want to give the assist money away. He effectively denied 50% of the gold there. So even though it looked like he went back and just killed himself, he was keeping the money away from Crumbs at least.
There
it
is was a method a good to move. The madness.
Yes.
It'll work out for him in the end. 24,000. We'll say 19,000. Round up for Dig on this one because they are still behind quite a bit of gold. Dragons in 1 minute and 20 seconds, but you also have to remember when things happen this fast in a game, you still have a mid game and a late game for things to change, so it's completely not over.
You're right. The dragon will be up in a minute. That's a huge comeback mechanic because you get so much more bonus experience if you are lower than the average levels in the game. And if Dignitas can make a play at bottom, catching one person from Fog of War or from a bush or something and get that objective, then that will be a really, really big step back in the game. But EG know this as well, and they don't want to let anything like that through. You can see how many wards they're purchasing. Vision is how they're going to keep control of this game. Because they have so many assassins and because they have the global pressure with Pantheon, all that they have to do is keep up the vision in both sides of Dignitas jungle, and they'll be free to make any movements around the map that they want.
Well, I still have, I wonder, I haven't kept tabs on that single pink ward right down that Zed Pobelter placed in the beginning.
It's last of the whole game.
That is the same ward.
That's the first blood sitting right there.
That's chilling.
In the river.
He's going to walk by it. Snoopy's going to use it right now. Inox coming down as well. It looks like they are trying to get a little more vision of the jungle as well as see what they can get out of Dignitas in the bottom lane.
4 versus 3 here. Even though there's a ward, it's not going to be enough time for them to get out.
Well, we know a Kiwi kid's going down. What else can they skewer in this one? They got a Cutie Pie and a Crumbs to go after here. Crumbs is a 1-2-3 count, and he goes down. We already see that Kiwi Kid has fallen, and they bounce Cutie Pie out of the fight, actually. Skara was trying to rush to bottom lane, but he gets the mid as they are scattering to push lane, scattering to get to a fight to disengage.
Yeah.
But it's all just a few seconds too late, and the dragon as well going to EG.
I have to say, at least they had perfectly concentric circles right there. It looked pretty
good
from Dignitas. Now Skara does not have any spells left. He's
bouncing toast. With him.
Boop. Man, this is brutal, actually, to watch at this point because the second dragon is off the table now since EG were the ones to make the move bottom. Where I was looking for the comeback move from Dig, EG just kind of pulled the rug right out from under them, and they're looking to just capitalize on this red side of the jungle. It's too dangerous for Dig now to go into even their own territory.
You know, EG's the one that we said we're not afraid to try things, and out of picks and bans, putting this Gragas up early in the picks. Skara didn't expect Ziggs versus Zed this game, and it's a 7-0 Zed now. The picks and bans went amazing for EG this game.
Yeah, they did. They adapted very well. I don't know. This is a very, very tough situation to Dig. At least they got one of the pink wards down over by Baron, which is a key word for comeback.
See, this is when it doesn't go well for your team, when the other one feels like they can initiate on any instance given to them. 13-1, 18 minutes in. It was almost under the turret that they got the man drop onto Kiwi Kid, but it doesn't matter. The turret's not really there to them.
Well, you see, everyone always talks about Pantheon. Oh, yeah, well, he's only an early game-oriented jungler, but he gets your team ahead early, and then he has the perfect ultimate for a team that's really far ahead early because he can force initiates. There's no way for Dig to get out of any of these man drops.
Yeah.
He's going to guaranteed lock somebody down there if they stay by that circle, if they don't have flash. So he's using it constantly over and over on cooldown to just increase the lead. This is the definition of the snowball here. EG are doing a very good job.
And the domino effect just completely multiplies because you're taking out Kiwi Kid, one of the hardest initiators for him. And when he melts as soon as he gets into the fight, then you have nobody to initiate anymore. So they're doing everything they need to on the side of EG to just stop this composition from Dignitas. The Seraph's Embrace trying to be finished up here by Skara as he charges that tier, but they're quite far off of those core items right now, which we are seeing in the inventories of EG.
I doesn't see the pink ward there. Very close. You gotta check all bushes all the time.
It's not like a tilt thing, right? They're kind of just panned over a different part of the map, but they're thinking about different things. There's so many things
19 minutes
going
in,
their head.
Don't expect there to be pink wards that deep in your territory.
Right.
But EG, like I said, extremely far ahead right now. Dignitas, they have to get a pick at this point. And it's sad for them because their comp is really good at sieging up. You know, if they were on even footing here, Caitlyn Ziggs plus the Trundle for Pillars
is
stop great
from getting
at
in.
Sieging up. But if you're down 10K gold at 19 minutes in, you can't really siege up. You have to just rely on trying to pick somebody out because you can't win. There we go. They got the pick.
Oh, they did get the cocoon that followed after, but it's the Lantern. We talked about Thresh being that support.
The
Ignite. Oh, my God. He lives. That would have been huge shutdown gold coming in.
Oh, that's heartbreaking for Dignitas right there. They just got their hopes up. And as we said in Champion Select, Thresh brings that defensive capability where you can escape from things that there would be no other possible way for him to get out of that.
Nope.
And he lives.
Even with the shadows,
here we go.
With everything he had, it's all they need. One quick pick, he's going to fall. He's got a little room to work with, but he goes down in the air. That's the Ignite of Crepo coming in. And EG is just kind of working this one textbook right now. They set up the zone for the next turret, and they're just going to push it down.
Yeah. And Fabelter still has his flash up because of the Lantern from Crepo.
Oh. That's nope. That's what she's saying.
Yeah, under the turret there. It's a little harass from Lucian. There's only a two-man siege here, too. Even Ziggs with blue buff having trouble keeping up with the deeps.
Well, they're not too far behind in levels. They are keeping up there, but the inventories aren't doing them any good in these fights. 5-1 in turrets, all that global gold in the pockets, 14 kills.
Snoopy is just, he's waiting for another Grand Skyfall. He was sitting up in that bush just looking for it, but Dignitas have backed off the turret wisely because there is that guaranteed initiate, and they just give it up.
Usually towards the end of a turret, a team will kind of start to pressure, and then engage the fight from getting antsy, but Dig knows they don't have much of a chance on that one right now. Trundle, you can see Cruiser after having a tough time at top lane. He's 20 CS down, but he's only got himself the Spirit Visage, trying to keep himself healthy if he even does get engaged down with the Giant's Belt as well.
Yep.
Oh, damn.
Nowhere for Crumbs to go.
That was a good dodge, but I think the last Q here, if he can hit it. Oh,
he wants it.
Got the cocoon on the way back around. It looks like they're going to get an Inox onto this one. It's a big wall. He gets himself through. He actually dodges out on the ace in the hole, but he stands still like a gentleman for that one.
All right. They got one kill to get back in this game. That's pretty big. You know, he had a bounty on him.
He did. Four kills. Four kills shut down.
They killed one person, and Pobelter's split pushing while the rest of his team is not creating any pressure. It's a little bit dangerous, and it's the small window that Dig could have to get back in this game. So if they catch, again, another single person out, and if they catch Pobelter, you know, that's a 7-kill streak right there. So that would be a 500 extra gold.
And you see, there was the same amount of wards in the top side of the jungle, but EG is going with the no fog of war strategy here on the bottom. Yeah. Pobelter has at least three or four wards above him. There were previously 9 on the map, so EG is making sure they keep themselves on top. They're not kind of saying, hey, we're in the lead, we should relax a little bit. They are going gung-ho on this right now, and Dignitas really cannot respond yet.
Well, EG have had control of the entire map for a good 5 minutes here.
Yeah.
So their gold lead just continually increases as they're able to take every single source of gold on the entire map, and it just gets worse and worse for Dig. They have to catch people out. It's really their only option. EG, look like they're going to be heading up towards Baron. That's a little bit risky, but it forces Dig out of the base, and it makes them choose between the split push and between the objective that is Baron.
It's what EG wants. It's what we want. We want to see some fights.
But Belter does not have any sort of teleport or global ulti to get up there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like a bait from EG. They're like, all right, Dignitas, if you come all the way out here, you better use your time wisely. And it's kind of baiting them into starting Baron. But Dignitas, they do not want to get anywhere near that Baron, it looks like. 5 or 4 even would be very rough for them.
The Mega Inferno Bomb kind of gives them a bit of idea of where Skara is in distance, and now that fully lets them know he is off the Baron and they are off having a chance. So that gets started by Evil Geniuses. Yep. Looks like they're going to get a little bit more in their backpack before an initial push in here. It's still hard to get past the Cruiser on Trundle and the Skara on Ziggs.
Four men chasing Pavelta around, but they're just out of range and they won't be able to grab him.
You can't chase a ninja. Doesn't work.
You can chase him, but you can't catch him.
Oh, ooh, I like it. You got me there. You can chase him. 45.2 to 31.5. Evil Geniuses here really working this one methodically. They haven't gone outside the box on this and gotten themselves in any dangerous positions, but there's still a lot of time left in this game. We're only 25 minutes in. We did see most of the game averages for a team are around 35, 36, and 37 minutes, so still a lot to happen.
I have to say, this game is going to give EG a lot of confidence, too, because the thing that they were struggling with before were the long engages, the overextensions from their jungler and from their support, who are the playmakers. Snoopy has been completely on point with his Grand Skyfalls all game long. He has been at the correct distance. It's a very hard ultimate to actually coordinate with your team, and he's done a very good job of it. So they've really cleaned up the play that they were looking to.
Snoopy finds a lot of nothing as he gets in there. A good flash by Cutie Pie. You can see him blinking on the bottom left of your screen as he's forced to the base. Not a lot of home guards have even been able to be picked up. You're still sitting on a lot of tier ones on the side of Dig. So this base, they just have to watch it go down.
Yep, Pabelter. He's done with his turret down bottom here. There's very few options for Dig. They haven't made their last stand at an inhibitor turret. And two inhibitor turrets are down. There's almost... I mean, the only other place that would be better to make a last stand would be at, like, the double Nexus turrets.
Right.
But that means that all of your inhibitors are already gone, and that would mean that they're sort of resigned to the Nexus explosion already. I guess they have to make their last stand at the mid turret now.
Thought they had a little bit more, having that Cruiser and Skara ready to just stop a siege, but with EG split-pushing their way to victory on this one, it looks like it could come quite soon. Eight turrets in their favor. Three are left on the map for Dignitas here. And like you said, that mid one is going to have to be protected after those outer inhibitors go down. EG just has a run of the mill right now. They can do whatever they want.
Yeah, so in Dignitas' position, like, while your inhibitor turrets are up, you're looking for that single pick on the outside, and you need a little bit of vision. But once the inhibitor turrets are down, you're pretty much confined to the base. And you have to sort of look for any position where you can get some extra tower damage because there's no way that they can handle the 5v5.
And EG keeps this going all game two. We remember just a bit back when they made Crumbs smite away the blue from Skara. Both Crumbs and Skara were already having a hard time at that portion of the game, so neither of them used the blue that they got. And EG has just been able to get under the skin of Dignitas every time for those buffs.
There's almost been no chance for Dig to even make a play, make one call. They haven't made, you know, any move towards any objective because EG have already taken everything on the map before Dignitas.
Still looking for more.
Now, Dignitas, as we said coming into this too, they're already on a losing streak. Mm-hmm. They went on that really nice winning streak, but now the tables have completely turned. And they're the ones that are going to have to start thinking about how do we rebound? What do we need to focus on now?
Now the week off seemed to kind of put a crutch on them. And they had that three-game week with two losses coming in.
There's the move. They're making the call, at least. They're going for it.
Almost there. The Talisman of Ascension was used there. Polebelter still on the bottom side now with a Guardian Angel. And Crepo still with his Talisman. EG ready to engage on Damore, and Dignitas is just scrambling right now to save the base.
Man, Pabelter even has a GA at this point, so even if they catch him, he'll probably take someone down while they kill him, and then he's just going to come back up with the GA proc.
EG with the suffocation hold right now, just squeezing a little bit tighter every so often. Now the last inhibitor turret standing in middle for Dignitas. 38 seconds on a dragon right now, but the Baron just wearing off here. Dragon could be worth some money, but Dig would have to get out of the base first.
I'm going to give Inox credit for buying the Scrying Orb, but it's not really useful in this situation. When you're ahead, you know where Dignitas are. They're inside their base, so you don't really need it.
It's pretty lit up.
He bought it for style points, And I guess you sort of get half credit for that one.
Well, a lot of the credit going to Inox is for kills as well. 4-1-3 in that top lane, pulling the Gragas up there. It's not the first time we've seen it this season. I believe Quaz was one to try it as well. But a 7-0-0 pole belter, as he hasn't gotten any more kills, but that's only because Dignitas has been staying so far away.
Exactly. There's nobody that can deal with him. As we said in the beginning of the game, if he gets a small lead, here we go.
Oh, Scarra gets jumped on right there. Inox able to come up with a kill. Cruiser doing what he can, trying to steal all those resistances. Yellow Pete's going to keep himself alive with a good peel from the team. EG looks to solidify the win here with a few final kills. Clocks are on 30 seconds, but they should have enough time.
Very, very well played from EG. They go with the all damage team in the face of Trundle, and they execute it just beautifully.
I actually may get pushed off of this one. The minion wave not being
too
close.
Oh, they got the GA.
It's going to be good for Poe Belter, or for them onto Poe Belter's GA. They're going to make sure the minion waves get in here, so if they do need to back off of anything, Dignitas is going to be left hanging. Looks like Crumbs needs to use that rappel to get himself out. They're able to get the first Nexus turret down, able to get the spider as well. Kiwi Kid and Cruiser about to come back up, but only to take a Polaroid of the Nexus going down. 30 minutes on the clock, 18-2. An amazing game played by Evil Geniuses from start to finish, and they pick up the win to make it 5-8.
They have got to be happy with that one. Well executed early game. They transitioned it so well into the double dragons that they got. Very, very well executed from EG. And, you know, they didn't give up their early lead. Even though Snoop kept making aggressive moves, deep skyfalls,
yeah,
it was always warranted because they knew where the rest of Dignitas were, and they knew they wouldn't be collapsed on, and they were able to get the kill almost every single time.
Dig has to be pretty shook after that game. Crumbs being the shot caller, and not to put the pressure onto Crumbs, just saying that shot caller, no calls really seemed to be made. It didn't seem like they were making bad calls, they just didn't have the chance. EG was always a step ahead, and when a team is a step ahead, we've heard, you know, Curse say it about CLG. You want to try this? Oh no, we can't. We want to try this? Oh no, we can't. And that's just what you fall into.
Yeah, I think definitely it's one of the worst positions to be in as a jungler when you make your first move and Snoop saw him, so he went back into his jungle.
Right, up top.
And the enemy jungler made a successful gank. That makes you feel bad. It makes you feel like you need to make something up and you need to go make something happen somewhere else.
Yeah.
But again, it was Snoop. Crumbs was not able to answer anywhere, and it really just was out of control that game, I have to say.
And that, you know, Snoopy coming in on that, that was a 0-1 for him on Pantheon. So he now evens up that score for himself, and that was a completely different showing than the first time we saw him. It was a little bit of a scramble, and he really didn't get the early game aggression of Pantheon out, and the whole team felt it. I mean, you do when you can't gank for your team.
Yeah, it was very well played by him.